A quick review. What we have done, we started a discussion on the transport layer, and we began a discussion with multiplexing and demultiplexing, and then we started having a look at principles of a reliable transport, and we were trying to develop a RDT, a reliable protocol, wherein we are developing it incrementally. So when we stopped in the last class, we were discussing the scenario where we assume that the channel which is communicating the packets has both errors and loss. And we also saw the protocol for that, that is RDT 3.0. I'll just repeat RDT 3.0 and then I'll proceed. So with RDT 3.0, we introduced the problem of loss, that a packet which has been transmitted by the sender can be lost in the network. And here we said that our approach towards a solution can be that the sender will now wait for some reasonable amount of time for the acknowledgement to come back. There is no way for the sender to know whether the packet that it sent was delayed, whether it was dropped by the router, or whether the acknowledgement did not come, or the acknowledgement was delayed a lot. So the only solution for all these scenarios remains that the sender will wait for a reasonable amount of time and then it will resend. So the retransmission is to be done if no acknowledgement is received in the whatever reasonable amount of stipulated time. Now, if the packet or the acknowledgement, either way, was only delayed but not lost, then what will happen? You have done a retransmission, but the original acknowledgement may come. In that case, your retransmission will be duplicate. So now you have duplicate packets flowing in the network and the receiver is likely to receive duplicate packets. But we have already introduced the concept of sequence numbers. Although the sequence numbers we have introduced are only 2, 0 and 1, but they will still handle this scenario that a packet which was received twice, you know, will be discarded. Now, that is why a receiver in every acknowledgement has to specify the sequence number of the packet that it is acknowledging, so that the sender will also know which package was received duplicate. So basically, to implement this, there is a need of a countdown timer. And this is more like a feature that operating system has to provide to the transport layer protocol, which is also a part of the operating system. But this leads to asynchronous code execution or non-sequential code execution, that you have to set a timer and then some particular function will get called when the particular timer expires. So that kind of code is not a sequential code where you call function A, then B, A calls B, B calls C, C calls D, and then they return in the reverse order. This is more of an event-driven code that you need to write in the operating system. So once again, I'm trying to show you the protocol for RDT3. And in RDT3, again, we have four states, two states indicating waiting for the application to call the transport layer protocol, and then two other states, wait for ACK0 and wait for ACK1, indicating that the sender is waiting for acknowledgement either for packet 0 or for packet 1. So these two, they form a pair, and the wait for acknowledgement 1 and wait for call 1 from above, they correspond to one particular packet being sent. So if initially the sender is in the wait for call 0 from above, then when it receives the request from the application, it will create the packet. Note that in this case, the packet will have the checksum, will have the sequence number 0, and it will call the underlying unreliable protocol UDT send to send the packet. But the additional thing in this case is it will also start the timer, and then it will move to wait for ACK0. Now, when it is in this state, multiple events are possible. But let us consider the best case scenario, that it receives a packet. The packet is not corrupted. This is done using the checksum, and it is actually an acknowledgement for the packet number 0. In that case, it can conclude that the packet was received properly and it can stop the timer. So now it can wait for the application to send the next packet. When the application sends the next packet, similar thing happens. So the diagram is actually, you will see, symmetric around this diagonal. And again, when it is in the wait for acknowledgement one state. When it receives that acknowledgement, it will move to the wait for call zero from above state. Now, the interesting thing happens if you are waiting for an acknowledgement, but there is a timeout. In the case of timeout, all you do is you just reset. And then you again restart the timer. That is important because even this one can get lost. And in that case, we'll keep resending and resending. The additional possibility that now arises because you have been retransmitting on a timeout is that you keep receiving acknowledgement for earlier sent packet because you have no idea whether the packet was reaching to the sender on time or it was delayed, and the receiver may keep sending duplicate acknowledgements. So you, even though you have moved to the next state, you can still keep receiving the acknowledgements for packet from other state. In that case, you can simply ignore it because this is a stop and wait protocol. You have only two possible packets to send, either packet 0 or packet 1. And if you are waiting for acknowledgement for packet 0 and you are getting acknowledgement for 1, there is nothing to be done. You can just simply ignore this. And similarly, there is, this diagram is symmetrical, and we can proceed now. So let us see some more examples of RDT3 in action. What happens in particular scenario? So suppose sender sends packet 0, it is received at the receiver side. Then the receiver is sent an acknowledgement. The sender will receive the acknowledgement. Then sender will send next packet, receiver will send the acknowledgement, and so on. So this is a wonderful scenario. Nothing is going wrong. Everything is working perfectly fine. Let us see now a scenario wherein we have a loss. So packet 0 was sent, acknowledgement 0 was received, but packet 1 was lost. In this case, remember, the sender has already started a timer for packet 1. And what will happen that the acknowledgement will not come in the specified time. So the sender will time out. In that case, the sender will resend packet 1. Now, hopefully the packet 1 will reach and the receiver will acknowledge and things will continue. So this was a simple scenario of a single packet loss. Let us think of more complicated scenarios. Sender is sending packet 0, received by a receiver. Receiver sent acknowledgement 0. Then it sent packet 1, the sender sent packet 1, but the acknowledgement was lost. Now remember, for the sender, there is no way to distinguish between the scenario B and scenario C. Scenario B when the packet 1 was lost. Scenario C when the acknowledgement 1 is lost. The sender has no way of knowing, or distinguishing between either of these two. So what will happen in this case? There will be a timeout, and after timeout, the sender will send packet 1 again. In this case, the receiver will actually get a duplicate packet. Okay. We have not seen the state diagram for the receiver, and it is my not only advice, I'm giving it to you as a homework. Although the diagram does exist in the list of slides that I have shared with you, but I'll urge you to try to write the state diagram for the receiver in this case, because the receiver in this case has to handle duplicates also. So what is the receiver going to do when it gets a duplicate? Obviously, it is not going to deliver it to the application, isn't it? The receiving side application, but it still has to send the acknowledgement because it will deduct that because it got the same packet twice, that must have been a retransmission. And retransmission must have happened because the acknowledgement was either lost or delayed. Because even the receiver has no way of knowing whether the acknowledgement that it sent was lost or delayed. So what it will do, it will send a duplicate ACK 1. And now when the receiver receives ACK 1, everything will continue as if it was routine. More complicated things happen if you have a premature timeout or a delayed acknowledgement. Remember, these are actually both the same scenario. I mean, a delayed acknowledgement will lead to a premature timeout, or a premature timeout basically means that the ACK was delayed. So in this case, see what is going to happen. In all earlier scenarios, B and C, we had some loss. So the packet was never going to reach. In this case, all packets are going to reach, but with a delay. So you send packet 0, you receive ACK 0. Now you send packet 1. The acknowledgement has been sent. The acknowledgement is still in the internet pipeline. It has not reached you yet, but the sender has timed out. What will the sender do? not knowing what exactly happened, it will resend packet 1. Now, what is going to happen at the receiver end when this fellow is going to resend packet 1? It is going to receive the duplicate of ACK 1, receive the duplicate of packet 1. So, it is going to send the duplicate of ACK 1. And remember, now there will be two ACKs, two ACK 1s in the pipeline. So, even the sender is going to receive duplicate ACKs. And now you can relate to the scenario where in the state diagram we discuss that you receive duplicate ACKs. So now packet 1 is also flying. Acknowledgement 1 is also flying. You never know when the acknowledgement 1 will be received by sender and duplicate packet 1 will be received by the receiver. But let us say the receiver receives packet 1, so it will detect the duplicate. It will again send acknowledgement 1. So two acknowledgement 1s are coming to the sender. Sender will get them at some point in time. The moment it gets the first ACK, it will conclude that the sending of packet 1 is over. So it can now switch to sending packet 0. So packet 0 will be sent. And with this, the normal flow should continue now. But remember, there is a duplicate ACK in the pipeline. So when the duplicate ACK is received, what should the sender do? Simply ignore it. And that's what we did in the state diagram. It will simply ignore it. And the transaction with acknowledgement 0 and then packet 1 and then packet 0, that will continue as if it was normal. So these are some interesting scenarios. Now, what we have done is, so far we have made a very simplistic assumption for sequence numbers that we have only a 1-bit sequence number. That is, we are interested only in sending one packet at a time. Now, that thing that you are going to send only one packet at a time until you receive the acknowledgement is going to have a penalty on the performance of your transmissions, because you may have a lot of data to send, but you have to hold that data until you receive the acknowledgement for earlier sent data. So let's try to analyze the performance mathematically. Let's introduce the term utilization of the sender, U sender, which is basically the fraction of the time the sender is busy sending. So here we are assuming that the sender has data. So when you have data, but you are not sending it, then you are basically waiting and wasting time. And that wasted time is underutilization. All right, so let's assume something like 1 Gbps link, 15 megasecond propagation delay, and 8,000 bit packet. Now in this case, the time to transmit the packet, we know it's simple, L upon R, that is 8,000 bits divided by 1 Gbps. So it will take 8 microseconds to transmit the packet into the channel. We have all done, you know, many examples of this type, so this should be easy to understand. Now, what happens when you have a stop and wait operation? The sender will send a packet. Now remember, this red color highlighted portion of the timeline that I've shown is the time taken for transmission to happen on the sender side. Now, this is referring to the time taken by the packet to reach to the receiver. And there is additional amount of time till the receiver receives the entire packet. And then the receiver will send you an acknowledgement. So the time taken for the packet to reach the receiver and the acknowledgement to come back is what we call as round trip time. Now, when the acknowledgement arrives, the sender will send the next packet. Now, how much is the time taken here? The time taken here is the round trip time plus the time taken for transmission. So remember, the round trip time is from the time last bit was transmitted by the sender till the acknowledgement is received. So you have to add additionally the transmission time. So that is the time taken. All right. Presentation has crashed and this keeps happening many times. So, okay, let me share entire screen and let me restart this. All right, in this case, now let us try to calculate the utilization of the sender. So, this is the round trip time as shown in the diagram. Then, the next part is the transmission time. Now, remember, the sender is only transmitting for the portion of L upon R. For the remaining time, it is just waiting. So the utilization is simple to calculate. It is L upon R divided by the total time. So if you put the numbers into it, then you will get this very small number of utilization, 0.00027. So it is highly underutilized. Okay. So the performance of this RDT 3.0 is very, very bad. And that is why you are not actually utilizing your infrastructure, because people spend tons of money in building the networking infrastructure. And if you are not transmitting using that infrastructure, then you are basically wasting the money spent in building that infrastructure. So we need to do better. And the better way of doing it is using what is called as pipeline protocols. So by pipelining, we simply mean we are going to allow multiple in-flight packets. So far we had only one in-flight packet, right? Either packet 0 or packet 1. But now we are going to make it more interesting, and that is obviously more complicated, by allowing the sender to have multiple in-flight packets. Now, obviously, if there are multiple in-flight packets, then we are referring to the packets which are yet to be acknowledged. And that is why one bit sequence number is not going to be sufficient. We will need a lot more sequence numbers, because we have to identify each of the packet that is in the flight. And that is why we may need now buffering at sender and or receiver. So and or receiver, because sometimes the receiver may do buffering, sometimes the receiver may not do buffering. But the sender needs to do buffering, because if you have multiple packets in flight, then obviously you are worried about each of them getting delivered. And remember, we are implementing a reliable protocol. So you want to ensure that they are received in order and they are received without bit errors. And if one of them is lost or one of them is delayed, then you should still be able to resend it and so on. And that is why the sender now needs to maintain some buffer. What is buffer? Buffer is basically, let's say, an array of bytes in which you can keep storing the data that you are going to send. So here is another diagram which shows, you know, a stop and wait protocol, that is a packet 0 or packet 1 protocol, wherein you are sending a packet and then you are getting the acknowledgement back. But if you have a pipeline protocol, then there will be multiple data packets, and that is why there will be multiple acknowledgement packets also in the pipeline. So this diagram shows multiple packets in flight. Now, obviously, pipelining is going to lead to increased utilization, because with the stop and wait protocol, we were only sending once and then waiting for a lot of time. But with pipelining, we are going to send even when earlier packet had not reached the destination or the acknowledgement had not come. So with multiple packets, we'll have increased utilization. So this diagram shows us that, let us say, we are going to send 3 packets. Then by the time the first packet is reaching, that is during this period, we have sent these 2 packets. Right? So there are 3 packets in the pipeline. And in this case, obviously, you have utilization that is more, that is because you have 3 packet pipelining, utilization will increase by 3 times. Now, obviously, if you want to utilize it more and more, then you have to keep sending more and more packets. This is assuming that the sender has packets. Okay, if the sender does not have packets, then anyway, your network will not get utilized. So this all calculation is assuming that the sender had packets to send. I could hear someone speaking. Do you have a question? I could hear someone speaking. Do you have a question? Okay, let me proceed. Now, if you want to implement multiple packets in flight, then there are 2 ways of doing this. And you have already studied these protocols in your course on data communication. But remember, when you studied them as they were data link layer protocols. While when we are studying them, we are studying them as they are transport layer protocols. What is the difference? Data link layer protocol will take care of multiple in-flight packets between 2 hosts in the same physical network. While here we are talking about transport layer protocol, which will take care of multiple in-flight packets between 2 hosts on internet. So this works across networks, while the link layer protocol works within the same network. The link layer protocol is often implemented in your hardware as a firmware, while this protocol exists as some code that runs as part of your operating system. So one protocol is go back in, and you would have guessed that the second protocol is selective repeat, so the same protocol. And because you already studied, I hope it will be easy for you to understand it, although I'll go slow and I'll try to cover all aspects of it. So with the go back in protocol, what does the sender do? The sender will now maintain a window of n consecutive transmitted but unacknowledged packets. And this window size can be adjusted, and more the size of the window, more is the memory requirement per connection. Obviously, if you have window of size up to n, then you have those, you need more sequence numbers, and that is why you don't, you cannot do with 1-bit sequence number. Now you will need a k-bit sequence number. That sequence number will obviously become a part of the packet header, whatever, you know, transport layer protocol header. So let's try to understand this diagram, because we are going to see this diagram many times, you know, over the next few slides. This diagram, or a diagram of this type. This diagram is showing us a timeline of packets to be transmitted by the sender. So you read it, you know, chronologically like this. The time increases towards the right side. And you will see that it shows a sequence of packets. So these are all sequence of packets, and they are color coded into four colors. The green ones are packets that are already acknowledged. So what are we talking about here? These packets were sent and acknowledged. So basically the sender can forget about them. The sender has actually forgotten about them. Once you send the data, you get an acknowledgement. So your job is done. So the green ones are forgotten by the sender. What we are interested in is, you know, the yellow ones and the blue ones. If you notice, the yellow ones and the blue ones total constitute n, and that is what we say is the window size. The yellow ones are packets which have been sent but not yet acknowledged. So they are in-flight packets, while the blue ones are fictitious or imaginary packets that will be transmitted in future when the application requests. Because your client, because your sender is maintaining a window that is a large buffer for n packets, it is not necessary that you have all the time n. You may have 0 up to n packets in flight, right? So as of now, what we are saying here, that these many packets are in flight, these many packets can still be transmitted by the sender. That is why they are, this indicates a set of usable packets but not yet sent. While the white ones, they are not usable. That means they are out of the window. So right now, you know, no application can try to send these many packets. Only, you know, the blue ones, like how many of them are there? 6. So only 6 packets can be sent as of now, while there are 8 packets in the flight. So we can say that the window size here is 14. 8 plus 6 is 14. Okay, now there are these two numbers here, the send base and next sequence number, and basically they indicate the they indicate the starting number of the packet which is sent but not acknowledged, and the starting number of the packet that will be sent next when the application makes a request. In the go back in protocol, there is a cumulative acknowledgement. So we write it using the notation ACK-N. And what does that mean? A cumulative acknowledgement means that all packets up to including sequence number N, you know, are getting acknowledged. So if you ever receive an acknowledgement number 5, then it means that the receiver received all packets up to 5. That means on the sender side, because all those packets have been acknowledged, you can now move the window forward to begin at n plus 1. So let us say you got acknowledgement number 8. So now here 6, these are 6 packets. 8 means this. So what you can conclude now is that out of the yellow ones, the first two have been received. And then you can say that your send base will start from here, the next packet. In the go back end protocol, the sender will maintain a timer for the oldest in-flight packet. In this case, which is the oldest in-flight packet? The packet given by sendbase, because all the yellow ones are in-flight and the packet indicated by sendbase is the oldest in-flight. Sorry. On a timeout, because it's a protocol which says go back N, on a timeout, what is done? That it will retransmit the packet N and all higher sequence number packets in that window. So N means, you know, it is a timeout for that particular packet. But then if that particular packet was not received, then the go back N protocol basically says that you have to retransmit all packets, you know, after that packet. In this case, what happens on the receiver side? The receiver will always send acknowledgement for a correctly received packet with the highest in order sequence number. The in order is highlighted, you will notice that. And because we have a protocol which we are claiming reliable, so the sender and receiver have to cooperate to ensure that the delivery is in order. So what is the receiver doing in this case? It keeps getting packets, but it will acknowledge, you know, the packet with the highest in order sequence number. So if it gets an out of order sequence number packet, then what is to be done is the question. So let us discuss that also in few minutes. But when it does that, it actually can generate duplicate acknowledgement. And conceptually, all it needs to do is only receive, you know, remember one number called RCU, receive base. What is receive base? If you look at this diagram, this is also a timeline of the receiver. And there are three color codes. The green ones are received and act. So you are done with them. The receive base is the packet you are expecting next because you have received all the green ones. The pink ones are packets which are out of order. They have been received but not acknowledged. While the gray ones are not received. So receive base is the smallest in order packet that you have not received. Now this one variable is sufficient, okay, in the case of receiver. Why? Because in case, you know, it doesn't send acknowledgement for the packet receive base, then the sender will time out and the sender will send all packets from this packet onward again. Now the receiver in this case can actually make a choice about the out of order packets. What it can do, it can either discard or store them. And that is the choice you have. If you say buffer, then you have to reserve some storage on the receiver side. And it is not mandatory to do that because reserving that array is consuming some resources. So to keep things low on memory, the receiver can in fact say that if I get out of order packet, I ignore it. Why do I ignore it? So you got these three packets out of order. You can say, I'm not going to store them. I'm going to discard them. So actually the color of them will not remain pink. The color of them will remain gray. And you will wait now for the sender to time out. And sender will send all packets from receive base onwards. Okay. Whenever it, you know, gets a packet out of order, all it keeps doing is it keeps re-acknowledging the packet with the highest in order sequence number. So this packet it had received, right? It will keep sending the acknowledgement with respect to that packet. So the sender will come to know that, you know, the acknowledgement for this packet did not come. So there was a timeout. So let's see some example of go back N. Now here we can see that the sender window size is 4 and the sequence numbers 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, they are there because your packets will be sent one after another, but at a time only 4 packets will be there in the flight. So let's say you have sent all the 4 packets, you are utilizing the complete window. Out of them packet 2 was lost. So what will happen in this case? Packet 0, and again here we are assuming that the delivery is kind of in order, but we could make it more complicated with the delivery out of order also. But let's say packet 0 is received and acknowledgement 0 is sent. Then packet 1 is received and acknowledgement 1 is sent. Packet 2 is never received, but packet 3 is received. In this case, we said that the receiver has a choice. It can store the packet number 3 or it can discard the packet number 3. Let's say it has discarded. But irrespective of what it does, it will keep sending acknowledgement for 1 only, because 1 was the last packet it received. So what will happen? The acknowledgement will keep flying. And remember, now there is a duplicate ACK, ACK 1. Now, when the ACK 0 is received by sender, the sender concludes that it can move the window by 1 because packet 0 is received. So its window now corresponds to sequence number 1 to 4. And that is why it can actually send packet number 4. Again, here we are assuming that the application had packet number 4 to send. So it will send packet number 4. When it gets acknowledgement for 1, it will again conclude that 2 packets were received. So it will move the window by 1 more number, and the window becomes now 2 to 5. And it will also send packet number 5. On the receiver side, interesting thing is happening. It is receiving packet 4 and packet 5. But because it has a mandate to deliver data in order and packet number 2 is not received. And secondly, it had chosen to discard the out of order packet. So it will keep discarding 4, it will keep discarding 5. In fact, for all of them, it will keep sending acknowledgement 1. The moment, you know, here what you do, get is you get a duplicate ACK for 1, you are going to ignore that because you already received that. So here now multiple acknowledgement once in flight. There is going to be a timeout after some time. Remember, the timer is always ticking for the oldest packet in flight. So who was the oldest packet in flight here? It was 2, the oldest in flight packet. And when the timeout happens, because the name is go back in, it will resend all the packets 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay. And then, you know, the normal sequence of events may proceed. So this is a example of go back in protocol in action. Now, go back in, obviously, you know, you can try to find a problem with go back in, that it will actually do unnecessary retransmission. Because you, even in the example, we have seen that packet number 4 and 5 were received, but you are still retransmitting them. Why? Simply because you have a policy that the sender will resend all the N packets in flight, while the receiver will simply keep discarding out of order packets. So it is a simple protocol, but it does carry with it the burden of retransmission. So another solution to this problem of multiple in-flight packets is called selective repeat. Once again, you all have studied this, so I hope it will be easier for you to understand selective repeat. The protocol is same. Okay, there is no difference in the protocol that you have studied in your second year and this protocol. The same protocol, the only difference is where does it execute. This protocol we are talking about will execute in the transport layer. All right. So with selective repeat, as the name suggests, repeat selectively. So obviously what this protocol intends to do is it will acknowledge each packet, you know, individually. So the receiver will individually acknowledge all the correctly received packets. And if you want to do that, then the receiver is mandated to buffer the packets. Why? Because you are going to acknowledge out of order packet, but you cannot deliver it to the application because it was out of order. So that means you have to store it for some time until you receive all the in order packets, and then you can deliver it to the application. So the restriction on the receiver is in this case to maintain a buffer. Okay. That was the choice in the case of go back in, but that is also, that becomes a mandate in the case of selective repeat. In this case, the sender, you know, will time out, and when it times out, it, you know, it will time out now for individual packets. In the case of go back in, because you are always going to retransmit all the packets, you had to only keep track of the oldest in flight packet, and you needed only one timer. In this case, you need a timer for every in-flight packet. Okay. And that makes it very complicated because there are multiple timers needed. So multiple timers is not a trivial thing, and handling those multiple timers is also not a that simple a thing. So implementing anything like selective repeat within an operating system code becomes a challenge. Okay. In this case, what happens to the sender window? Sender window will have n consequent sequence numbers because we have a size of n, window size n. And it will, okay, let's try to understand it through this diagram. Same diagram, okay, this is not different. The same color codes are being used. The green color packets are already acknowledged packets. The yellow ones are sent but not act. The blue ones are usable, not yet sent. What is the difference between this diagram and the earlier diagram? Is that the yellow and the greens are now interspersed, you know, in this part of the window size n. Because some may be acknowledged, some may not be acknowledged, and you can have this fragmented scenario with selective repeat. We are using the same variable send base and next sequence number, you know, that we used in go back end. What happens on the receiver side now? Because receiver is also going to maintain a buffer. The size of the buffer has to be n, that is the window size which is used by the sender, because you may have to keep buffering all the n minus 1 packets until you receive that one out of order packet. So here the color coding says that the pink ones are out of order packets, but they are already ACK. So you will notice that this is the portion you are done with, and you are waiting for the next in order packet that is indicated by receive base. So this packet is yet to be received. This packet, when you receive, will be given to the application, but you have not got it. But you have got some other packets. Those are indicated by the pink color. The blue ones are, you know, you can keep receiving them because they are, you know, they can fit into the buffer. Remember, the receiver has no way of knowing how many packets the sender has sent. It comes to know of a packet only when it receives the packet. So here we are assuming that the sender and receiver both are meeting a window of size n. What does the sender do in the case of selective repeat? When the application says send, what it will do, it will check if, you know, the window has some size left. If the window does not have size left, then it will simply discard the request from the application. But if the window has size left, then it will check the next available sequence number in the window and then construct the packet and send it. Remember, for every such packet, there will be a timer. So the timer has to indicate that it timed out for which particular packet in transit. And that is, I said, you know, is a challenging thing. But let's say that is done. So in that case, you come to know, the sender comes to know that it has to resend the packet number n and then restart the timer for that packet only. When you get an acknowledgement, remember the acknowledgement will be now for any particular packet in the window. The sequence number of the window is indicated by send base to send base plus n. So what you can only do is you can mark that packet as received. And if it was the smallest unacked packet, that is packet with this number, send base number, then you can advance the window base to the next unacked sequence. That you can always do. Now remember, this is smallest unacked packet, but this is smallest next unacked sequence number, because it is possible that you had got send base plus 2, send base plus 3, send base plus 4, and then you got send base. So you will not increment to send base plus 1, but send base plus 5, because 2, 3, 4 were already received. So the acknowledgement mechanism will keep checking the acknowledgement number and advancing the window base to the next unacked sequence number. On the receiver side now, you can receive any packet in any order. Well, it will only receive packets in, you know, this window range. If it receives the packet outside this window range, it is going to discard, not going to work on it. But a packet in this sequence number range, receive base to receive base plus n minus 1, can be received in any order. As soon as you receive it, you buffer it and you send the acknowledgement for that particular packet. So you buffer it only if it is out of order. Actually, if it was already in order, then you can deliver it to the application and move the window ahead and forget about that packet. But you keep buffering it if it was out of order. If the packet was in order, you deliver it. But when you deliver it, you also deliver the subsequent packets that were received beforehand. So like you received receive base 2, receive base plus 3, receive base plus 4, and then you received receive base, then you will deliver all the in order packets. That's obvious. If you receive a packet which is in this range, receive base minus n to receive base minus 1, then in that case you can simply acknowledge the already received packet, and otherwise if you receive any packet which is out of range, then you ignore it. Let's understand it through an example. So sender has a window size of 4. So same scenario, okay, that we did with go back n, but we'll try to understand how it plays out differently in the case of selective ripping. So you had 4 packets and packet number 2 was lost. On the receiver side, you receive packet 0, you acknowledge 0. You receive 1, you acknowledge 1. The interesting thing happens when you receive packet number 3. Here you are going to buffer, mandatorily buffer, you don't have a choice. And you will send acknowledgement for 3. Meanwhile, what happened? The acknowledgements for 0 and 1 were in flight. Now the acknowledgement for 3 is in flight. On the sender side, as soon as you receive acknowledgement for 0, your window can move forward by 1 and you can send the packet number 4. Even that will be received and buffered on the receiver side, and acknowledgement 4 will be sent. Things repeat for packet number 1 and its acknowledgement. The sender will increment the window and send packet number 5. That will also get buffered. Why are we buffering? Because number 2 is not yet received. So 3, 4, 5 are received, they are buffered. Acknowledgement for 5 is also sent. Now, the acknowledgement for 3 will arrive, all right, on the sender side. So what has the sender got so far? Acknowledgement for 0, acknowledgement for 1, and acknowledgement for 3. What is it supposed to do now? Is it supposed to do anything like retransmission? No, it is supposed to wait for timeout. So when the timeout for packet 2 actually happens, then it will only resend packet number 2, but not 3, 4, 5. And that is where the difference comes in. The moment receiver receives packet 2, and it has already buffered 3, 4, 5, so it will deliver all the 4 to the application, but it will send acknowledgement for 2 only, because it only received packet number 2. When on the sender side you receive packet number 2, what will happen? Can somebody try to tell what will happen on the sender side when the acknowledgement for 2 arrives? What has happened on the sender side for acknowledgement number 3, 4 and 5 is not shown in this diagram. Okay, only 3 is shown, but not 4 and 5. So what did we discuss about the sender when it receives the acknowledgement? What will it do? What does the diagram tell us? And what happens now when acknowledgement number 2 occurs? What do you think the sender will do? Let me give you some time to think about it. You can write the answer in the chat or you can speak. What happens when acknowledgement 2 arrives? Okay, let me tell you. Assume that acknowledgement 3, 4 and 5 were also received. Assume that acknowledgement 3, 4 and 5 were also received.
Move the window to the 6.
Move the window starting with 6 or starting with
6.
Starting with 6. Now let's go back a little bit. Is it stuck? Okay. So LibreOffice has a bug in playing an animation backwards. All right. So as we said here, if n smallest unacked packet is received, the acknowledgement for that is received, then you advance the window base to the next unacked sequence. So this route. You advance it to the next unacked sequence. So that is why 3, 4, 5 are already received. Now you receive 2, so you move on to 6. Right, that's what you do. Let me play it quickly. Go ahead. Okay, any questions about selective repeat and go back in? Nothing in the chat. Let me proceed. Now, selective repeat has a peculiar problem with it. Okay. Let us understand it with this example. Suppose you have a window size of 3, so 3 packets can be in flight, and then you have sequence number 0, 1, 2, 3, and so on. So here is a sender window. Okay, sender window 0, 1, 2, 3, again 0, 1, 2, because you have sequence numbers in 2 bits. Okay, sequence numbers in 2 bits, while the window size is 3. This is an interesting scenario we have created to understand the problem of selective repeat. Why 2 bit? Because, you know, the programmer thought 2 bits are sufficient, you know, so 2 bits. So sender window is shown here. Sender window will have sequence number 0, 1, 2, 3, again 0, 1, 2, and so on. Because, you know, the sequence numbers always need to be recycled. No matter how many bits you choose for sequence number, you will always have a limit, right? Let's say you choose 10 bits for the sequence number. Then you have a limit of 2 to the power 10, and then you have to recycle the numbers. So window size is 3, so 3 in-flight packets. So packet 0, 1, 2. Right, they are sent. Now, what does it say here? When you receive packet 0, the receiver window advances. You receive packet 1, the receiver window advances. You receive packet number 2, the receiver window advances. All right, that is what happens. So the acknowledgement comes back here. Acknowledgement comes back here for 0 and 1. So the sender window has also advanced to 230. Now, when you receive the acknowledgement for packet 0, you could now send the next packet, that is packet number 3. So packet number 3 was in flight, but it got lost. Right. Now what will happen? There's no problem in this scenario. The problem is, if you send 3 packets, the acknowledgement for all of them are lost. So there will be a timeout for packet number 0. The interesting thing has happened on the receiver side. The receiver, because it received all these 3 packets, it moved its window to this range, 301. Now, when there is a transmission timeout, it will send the packet number 0 again, because first it will timeout for packet 0. Now, the receiver is actually going to receive the packet, which is this numbered packet, while it was supposed to receive this packet. So, why is this problem occurring? This problem is occurring because there is a particular kind of arithmetic trouble with the size of sequence number that you have and the size of the window. So this also happens because the receiver is not able to see the sender side. And the receiver's behavior is same in both the cases. Okay, like in both these cases, the receiver simply kept, you know, moving its window ahead. That's what you're supposed to do, right? With the protocol we described. That when you receive a packet, you keep moving your window ahead. So what happened is not correct. Okay, you were supposed to receive the retransmitted packet, but you accepted the packet as if it was the next sequence number. So that's a very simple question to ask. What kind of relationship do we need between the sequence number size and the window size to avoid this problem? Can somebody try to give a quick answer? How big should be the sequence number, let's say in bits, or because it will be power of 2, right? You have 3 bits, so it will be 8. You have 4 bits, it will be 16. So what should be the sequence number size and the window size? What should be the relationship between them to avoid this problem? Obviously, in this case, we can see that the window size is smaller than the total number of sequence numbers. So will it work if I simply say window size has to be at least as big as the sequence number size? By sequence number size, I mean to power n. Can we say that the window size has to be at least as big as the window size? Will saying that work? Or it has to be at least one more than the sequence number size? So I leave it to you as a problem to think about. What should be the relationship? Okay. Whether it should be more than or it should be more than equal to. The window size should be more than or more than equal to sequence number size. Think about it. And if you can come up with a more refined answer, please try to come up with a more refined answer. All right. So we are done with now reliable data transfer and reliable data transfer with pipeline, wherein we have multiple packets in flight. And we have seen the solution called go back and end selective repeat. So basically, these two are, we'll say, two interesting solutions in theory. TCP doesn't use either of them. TCP doesn't use either go back in or selective repeat. It actually uses an interesting mix. And we will see that interesting mix because we are going to learn TCP today in the remaining time we have. So we'll see how TCP does it. But it was necessary to get introduced to the principles like RDT1, RDT2, RDT3, and go back and selective repeat before we try to understand how TCP works. Any questions? Okay, something in the chat. Oops. You can give me a feedback whether the speed was okay today, because many of you have given me the feedback that now the lecture is often very fast. You can give me a feedback if you think that the
only one other
the pace was okay. Yes, who is that? Okay, can you mute yourself? Can you mute yourself? Whoever that is, I'm going to mute all. It takes time to mute all. No questions? All right, wonderful. So now we'll move on to understanding TCP. And we have 3-4 minutes left in this lecture. So we'll just begin with TCP, then we'll take a break, and then we'll again resume the next. So just an overview of the features of TCP. So for TCP, is a connection-oriented protocol. Please mute yourself, number 143. We know TCP is a connection-oriented protocol. It is a point-to-point. Point-to-point means it is from one host to another host, and those are the two points you are talking about. And it basically connects only one sender with one receiver. Okay. So you don't have multiple hosts talking to each other. You only have one client and one server, or basically one sender and one receiver in the TCP. TCP gives us reliability. It gives us an in-order byte stream. And interestingly with this, you know, because the byte here you will see is italicized, there are no message boundaries. Okay, like TCP will say that a message is nothing but the sequence of bytes, and the earlier part of the message ends on one byte and the next part of the message starts on the next byte. So it does not distinguish between, you know, any kind of predetermined boundaries between messages. It simply says I get a stream of bytes, I send a stream of bytes, and that is very nice, because we want to deal with data as a stream of bytes, not as artificially crafted packets, but stream of bytes. Whenever you create a TCP connection, it is full duplex. Full duplex means you can transmit in both directions. Okay, it's a bi-directional data flow. With the same connection, the sender can send to the receiver and the receiver can send to the sender. Then the relationship is reversed actually. But basically, both parties can talk to each other. TCP interestingly also has this notion of what is called as maximum segment size, and we will visit this concept. It is actually used to break the application data into smaller chunks so that you can deal with the underlying network, and the underlying network can carry the data. So we will come to know how the maximum segment size is normally determined. TCP uses the concept of cumulative acts, and we know what is cumulative acts. Cumulative act basically means that if you receive multiple packets, then you keep acknowledging, you know, all the earlier packets, you know, cumulatively. Okay. TCP uses pipelining, but not go back in or selective repeat. It uses a different kind of mixture. So with TCP, you can have multiple in-flight packets. So obviously it leads to more utilization, because with the stop and wait, we had very small utilization. With pipelining, it increases. But with TCP, a very interesting and complicated thing happens. There's a window size to be determined, right, for pipelining. In TCP, the window size is not fixed. The window size itself is dynamically computed using something called as congestion and flow control algorithm part of the TCP. So that is a very interesting part of TCP. Then we know that TCP is connection oriented, that you have to establish a connection. So before the client and server can call send and receive, they have to call accept and connect. And part of the connect and accept, some messages are exchanged, that is called handshaking. That will actually initialize the sender and receiver state. So basically allocating buffers, initializing those indices and so on, that will happen as a part of connection. And TCP is further what we say flow control. And this is another very interesting feature which makes it complicated. What is happening here is that the sender is actually always thinking that am I too big for the receiver? Like suppose you have a very high-end laptop and I have a very, very old low-end desktop with very low amount of RAM. Then perhaps my operating system is not going to allocate as much buffer memory for the socket connection as your operating system can allocate. And then you can actually keep trying to send a lot of data, but I'm not in a position to receive it. So TCP does a very interesting thing. It does what is called as flow control, wherein the sender says that I'm not going to send data which you will not be able to receive. So I'm not going to send data at a higher rate or more data than what you as a receiver can receive. So that is called flow control. Remember, flow control is not the same as congestion control. Congestion control is TCP taking care of the congestion in the network and then reducing the rate at which it transmits. While flow control is taking care of the capacity of the receiving client and then sending the data. So we'll just take a break of 5 minutes and we'll resume again at 11. Yeah, because we started at 9:50. So we'll take a break and we'll resume again at 11.